Blackstone Audio presents NeuroTribes, The Legacy of Autism and the Future of Neurodiversity by Steve Silberman. This book is read by William Hughes. For Keith Carricker. Foreword by Oliver Sacks. I first met Steve Silberman in 2001. He was a young journalist then, assigned to do a profile of me before the publication of my memoir, Uncle Tungsten. He quickly gained my confidence, and I was to spend many hours talking with him, going with him to London, where I grew up, and introducing him to many of my friends and colleagues. Steve always dug deeper, asked more penetrating questions. He thought about things and made connections. Around that time, he developed an interest in the growing epidemic of autism and Asperger's syndrome. He had been intrigued when I wrote about Temple Grandin and the savant artist Stephen Wiltshire in An Anthropologist on Mars. And now, he set out to talk to researchers, physicians, and therapists, parents of autistic children, and most importantly, autistic people themselves. I know of no one else who has spent so much time simply listening, trying to understand what it is like to be autistic. Steve's journalistic instincts and skills led him to do a tremendous amount of research, illuminating, as no one has before, the history of Leo Kanner and Hans Asperger and their clinics, as well as those who followed. He has portrayed the remarkable shifting of attitudes toward autism and Asperger's over the past few decades. NeuroTribes is a sweeping and penetrating history of all this, presented with a rare sympathy and sensitivity. It is fascinating reading. It will change how you think of autism, and it belongs alongside the works of Temple Grandin and Clara Claiborne Park on the bookshelf of anyone interested in autism and the workings of the human brain. Introduction. Beyond the Geek Syndrome. There is more than one way to do it. Larry Wall. On a bright May morning in 2000, I was standing on the deck of a ship churning toward Alaska's Inside Passage with more than 100 computer programmers. The glittering towers of Vancouver receded behind us as we slipped under the Lion's Gate Bridge, heading out to the Salish Sea. The occasion was the first Geek Cruise, an entrepreneur's bid to replace technology conferences and lifeless convention centers with ocean-going trips to exotic destinations. I booked passage on the ship, a Holland America liner called the Volendam, to cover the maiden voyage for Wired magazine. Of the many legendary coders on board, the uncontested geek star was Larry Wall, creator of Perl, one of the first and most widely used open-source programming languages in the world. Thousands of websites we rely on daily, including Amazon, Craigslist, and the Internet Movie Database, would never have gotten off the ground without Perl, the beloved Swiss Army chainsaw of harried systems administrators everywhere. To an unusual and colorful extent, the language is an expression of the mind of its author, a boyishly handsome former linguist with a Yosemite Sam mustache. Sections of the code open with epigrams from Larry's favorite literary trilogy, The Lord of the Rings, such as, "A fair jawcracker dwarf language must be." All sorts of goofy backronyms have been invented to explain the name, including pathologically eclectic rubbish lister. But Larry says that he derived it from the parable of the pearl of great price in the Gospel of Matthew. He told me that he wanted the code to be like Jesus in its own humble way, free, life-changing, and available to everyone. One often used command is called bless. But the secret of Perl's versatility is that it's also an expression of the minds of Larry's far-flung network of collaborators, the global community of Perl hackers. The code is designed to encourage programmers to develop their own style, and everyone is invited to help improve it. The official motto of this community is, "There is more than one way to do it." In this way, the culture of Perl has become a thriving digital meritocracy, in which ideas are judged on their usefulness and originality rather than on personal charisma or clout. These values of flexibility, democracy, and openness have enabled the code to become ubiquitous, the duct tape that holds the internet together, as Pearl hackers say. As the Volendam steered into open water, I watched with admiration as my fellow passengers pulled Ethernet cables, routers, and other networking paraphernalia out of their bags to upgrade the ship's communication systems. Instead of dozing in chaise longues by the pool, my nerdy shipmates were eager to figure out how things work and help make them work better. By midweek, they persuaded the captain to give them a tour of the engine room. Each evening, as our ship climbed toward the Arctic Circle, Larry made a dramatic entrance to the ship's dining hall on the arm of his wife, Gloria, sporting a ruffled shirt and neon tuxedo. He wore a different color tuxedo each night, in a retina-scorching array of lime, orange, sky blue, and mustard, made possible by a going-out-of-business sale in his hometown. Belying the stereotype of hardcore coders as dull and awkward conversationalists, Larry and my other companions at the wizard's table displayed a striking gift for puns, wordplay, and teasing banter. One night, the topic of conversation was theoretical physics. The next, it was the gliding tones of Cantonese opera, followed by thoughts on why so many coders and mathematicians are also chess players and musicians. The tireless curiosity of these middle-aged wizards gave them an endearingly youthful quality, as if they'd found ways of turning teenage quests for arcane knowledge into rewarding careers. On weekends, they coded recreationally, spinning off side projects that lay the foundation of new technologies and startups. After a few days on the ship, I came to feel that my fellow passengers were not just a group of IT experts who happened to use the same tools. They were more like a tribe of digital natives with their own history, rituals, ethics, forms of play, and oral lore.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.